Great. Appreciate everybody joining. We're going to be talking about something near and dear to my heart, Walt Disney, the king of the American frontier. As I mentioned when I put out the information about the talk today, when I was doing my book on Disney television, I just had a great time doing the TV section on the Frontierland. As a kid, I'd grown up watching Davy Crockett and Zorro and Swamp Fox and so many of the other odds and ends, that it was more fun watching those shows than some of the others to take notes. What was really nice was I got to talk to a whole bunch of the people that had done the shows, and I'll talk today as I'm going through it about working with Bess Parker and a few things, and Buddy Baker, some of the people, the behind the scenes folks. So it was a lot of fun. And let me just get ready to start screen sharing here, and we'll jump into it. I'm just going to put everybody on mute. If you do have questions or anything, you can pop them up in chat or get them to me at the end. But let's sh share screen. We'll remember to optimize for video and share sound because I do have a bunch of videos here. And I just need to find out where this thing has gone. So let's see. Okay, PowerPoint. So hopefully you can see PowerPoint now. And I'm going to put it into presentation mode. Oh, and now my dog is throwing up on my lap. Excuse me, one second. What a day. Bailey.
Oh, talk among yourselves.
Bailey, she's throwing up. Oh, grab her.
That hasn't happened before.
No, but that's one of those things that gets your attention right away.
It's a sound you don't soon forget. So I'm sorry, we'll edit this part out of the video, but our dog loves to go out and eat things like dates from palm trees or olives from the olive tree down the street. Doesn't realize every time you do it, one of those pits gets in your stomach and a day later you're gonna throw up. So we try to watch her like a hawk, but she tends to do it. So anyway, we will start the tape again in a moment. So anyway, Walt Disney, King of the American Frontier. I was really lucky. I started work at Disney back in 1976, and the back lot was still out there. All the Western streets, the things you see on TV, and we'll be showing some pictures of the back lot. But it was great fun to be able to walk through it and put yourself back in the days when you're 8 years old or so and watching Texas John Slaughter or Elfego Baca. And then you get to meet some of the characters. It was really interesting. So a little bit of background. Walt, the Wild West was still young, was still alive when Walt was young. It's hard to believe, 1901, that a lot of the famous figures we hear about today have been immortalized in TV shows and movies and all that, were still alive. Walt, grew up in the Midwest. When we talk about the American frontier, of course, the frontier changes. The frontier of the days of the Revolutionary War was one place. The Civil War was further west. So we'll be moving around the course of the country. But a lot of these stories were really still big and going on at the time. You had Buffalo Bill Cody, still alive. He had been famous for all the shows he did and everything. Same with Annie Oakley. Calamity Jane doesn't look real happy there, but I wouldn't argue with her with that in her hand. And even people like Wyatt Earp, you hear about the OK Corral and everything, but, trying to think about it, that he was still on the circuit and making speeches and, signing autographs and doing that sort of thing back in the days when Walt was growing up. So I'm sure lots of stories circulating. Even people like Geronimo, who actually appears in several of the Disney shows, still out there. And, he was making a living signing his name very laboriously. He would print it out and... But still famous people out there. There were also only 45 states at the time Walt was born. You start thinking about, there were 48 for years. Well, yeah, but Oklahoma, New Mexico, and Arizona became states well after Walt was alive. So you talk about the frontier, it was still the Oklahoma territory, the Arizona territory, that they weren't even states yet. So Walt spent a lot of time on the road as he worked on the trains, and supposedly he loved to read the paperback novels and things like that at the time, all sorts of stories of the Wild West and adventurers and everything heading out there. And you can see it really made an impact on him. Because when he started his early cartoons, he had quite a few of them that were Western themed. He had the Alice cartoons. Most people probably are already familiar with it, but in case anybody's not, it was a live action gal, Virginia Davis, being in the cartoons, and they were everything animated around her. So he did quite a few of them. I think this was the earliest one, Alice's Wild West show. Then we have Alice in the Woolly West, Julius the Cat there. Alice at the Rodeo, again, all Western themes. Unfortunately, some of them have been lost, so we only know what the names or the you know, the scripts are, but no images. But Alice in the Klondike, Alice's Medicine Show. And then we move out of Alice into Oswald the Lucky Rabbit. So again, Western themes come out here. You have Sagebrush Sadie, one of the first ones. Some of the cartoons from here have been lost too. So you end up with things like the Plowboy story sketches. You'd almost think it was Mickey if you look in the second sketch down on the left there, but Oswald the Lucky Rabbit. Another Western one out there in the Yukon. He moves over to Mickey Mouse, and one of the very first cartoons they do. And we all know about Steamboat Willie and that famous first sound cartoon, first release, not necessarily first been filmed, but Galloping Gaucho is a early short. And he continued a stream of them. We had the Cactus Kid, Pioneer Days. Don't the oxen look super happy to be heading out west? I mean, they're probably glad to get away from the eastern weather. Klondike Kid and Two Gun Mickey, a great, great cartoon. I really enjoy the classic Mickey from these days. As he moved into theatrical features, we started getting things of the frontier, the Martins and the Coys, a feud of people out there in the, again, the mountains. Today you wouldn't think of, say, West Virginia or Tennessee, that being the frontier. But at one point, that was as far west as anybody had gotten. Johnny Appleseed, we'll talk about how he almost became part of the Disneyland TV anthology, but heading out west and spreading apple trees everywhere he goes. Pecos Bill, the rootin' tootin' guy out there with his horse Widowmaker. And the Lone Chipmunks, another Western-themed cartoon. So he did all these theatrical projects, and along comes television. He had long wanted to build his theme park. He had divided into four different lands, and one of the lands was Frontierland. Now, a lot of people at Disney today think that the park came first, and then the TV shows, or which was the, they think that the other way, actually. But that's what happened, is they came up with the idea for the various lands, Frontierland, Main Street, all that, and Frontierland. At this point, he knew he had Frontierland, but they didn't know what they were going to do for the TV show. And we'll take a look at some of the planning in that. So he knew he wanted to do something different from just the usual shoot 'em up, odors that were online. But one of the very first things he said in the story meeting, see the first quote here about he didn't want glorified heroes, bad men rather. So he wanted heroes. He wanted people that the kids could look after, see as role models in that. And they did a whole bunch of things. The story department was throwing out all sorts of ideas of who to go. And then Bill Walsh down here, great quote. They picked Davy Crockett. And if they hadn't picked Davy Crockett, would the TV series in general, Appleseed, be anywhere near successful? Probably not. They did get the Daniel Boone later. Until I saw this quote, I never heard of Bigfoot Wallace, but I don't think that would have been the same hit. But just absolutely by dumb luck, they pulled out Davy Crockett. And Davy was a huge hit. It's still TV that's hard to believe. You have Bess Parker had been a minor player in movies like Them, came to Walt's attention. On the right, Buddy Epson had actually tried out for the role of Davy Crockett and ended up getting the sidekick. But the casting was wonderful. And another thing that was really amazing at the time was these shows were shot out on location. Television was really a cheap thing back in the mid-1950s. Almost everything was done on the back lot or as close to the studios in California as you can get to. But Walt went out and shot these on location, and he also shot them in color. There was nobody shooting color television in 1954. I mean, it just wasn't done. But Walt did it, and he had the thought of two things. One is that there were already early experiments going on in color television. So if I do it in color today, I could reuse it later. But also, maybe I can do something with this theatrically overseas where people aren't going to be watching ABC television. Maybe I can make some of my money back at least, you know, because color costs more, obviously, to light and to process the film and everything. But he had the foresight that if he spent a little extra, maybe he'll make just a little extra more. And it turned out to be an amazing, amazing look into the future for how the industry went. So the very first show he did was Davy Crockett, Indian Fighter, aired back on December 15th, 1954. We're going to see a video clip in a second. But, you know, it's easy today to look back at Crockett Mania, and we'll talk more about that in a moment. But here we come, December 15th. Nobody's seen or heard of Davy Crockett. There had been another movie another studio did, went nowhere. And then basically nobody heard of Fess Parker. And all of a sudden, lightning was going to strike.
Walt Disney's Disneyland.
When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are.
Each week as you enter this timeless land, one of these many worlds will open to you. Fantasyland, the happiest kingdom of them all. Tomorrowland, promise of things to come. Adventureland, the wonder world of nature's own realm. Frontierland, tall tales and true from the legendary past. Presenting this week from Frontierland, Davy Crockett, Indian Fighter. And now, Walt Disney.
It's characteristic of American folklore that most of our favorite legends and fables are based on the lives of real men, like Davy Crockett of Tennessee.
Born on the mountaintop in Tennessee, green estate in the land of the free, raised in the woods so he knew every tree, killed him a bar when he was only three. Davy, Davy Crockett, king of the wild frontier. He went off to Congress and served a spell, fixing up the government and laws as well. Took over Washington, so we heard tell, and patched up the crack in the Liberty Bell. Davy, Davy Crockett, seeing his duty clear. He heard of Houston and Austin, and so to the Texas plains he just had to go, where freedom was fighting another foe, and they needed him at the Alamo. Davy, Davy Crockett, king of the wild frontier.
And now, from Davy's own journal, the first of three stories, The Indian Wars.
So I'm sure we'll have that song sitting in our heads for a little bit of time. Now, what's interesting is you go back and you, we'll talk about the song more in a moment. You look at the shows back then, and there were a number of Westerns coming along. You know, the days of Sugarfoot and Maverick and Bronco, Have Gun Will Travel, all sorts of Westerns. But one of the things that if you look at the Disney shows and pay attention to them, they obviously had a lot of mayhem in it. We have the Indians here attacking, and then Davy's going to be fighting him back. But what I find interesting in looking back at it from today's eyes of you know, political sensitivity and that, Because if you look at it, the Indians were always treated as a sympathetic situation. They weren't just bloodthirsty savages out to kill people for the sake of killing people. They're people living their lives, and all of a sudden these invaders come marching down the hill and start taking over their land. And most of us would probably react the same way if somebody just showed up and said they were taking our house away from us. So in these shows, it's interesting. Lots of fighting, lots of animosity. But Davy and the Indians come to understand each other. And this was a great epic battle they had here. And they decide to become friends. And Davy actually becomes a supporter of the Indians. We're going to see more about that coming up. But that's seen through many of the Disney shows. You know, it wasn't just the savages grunting and you know, rampaging. They had a reason for what they were doing, one we could probably relate to. Mention the song. It's pretty interesting, as I mentioned here on the slide. The show came in short. They shot out in production. They took it back to the studio. They edited it. And now it was it came out 2-3 minutes too short. So they had to fill it up with time. Normally, if it was shot in the back lot, you'd call Chris Parker, buddy, ask him to come in for a day. They'd go and do some sort of, you know, nonsense out there with a horse or a stagecoach or something. But the back lot wasn't ready for shooting. You had the show done on a location. Sending a crew back out there to do it again would have been incredibly expensive. So they had to come up with a way to fill up the time. They did it, as you saw. They took some of the pre-production sketches they had done where they were trying to figure things out. And then Tom Blackburn and George Bruns came by and wrote the song. So it became a huge hit. I mean, everybody heard the song, and the next day the school kids are going there and trying to get the, you know, remember what they had heard. Because again, there was no DVR, you couldn't go back and replay it, but they had heard the song. And now they could start hearing it everywhere because people started rushing out records like mad. You can see this particular one from this company, Cadence Children's Series, #1. Hey, let's get on board with this. The Ballad of Davy Crockett, not by anybody from Disney, but it was Bill Hayes. They had just licensed the music from Disney, put it out there. That became a big hit. So, of course, Disney had to jump on it. Let's get Fess Parker to do a record for us. Matter of fact, after a while, it looked like almost everybody was doing records about Davy Crockett. So different versions, different covers. This is a 45 RPM record. This particular picture is one of my favorites of Fess. So I asked him to sign it for me when we were doing a show together in Chicago. And when I took it out and I gave it to him, he said, "Oh man, I've always hated that picture." And I told him it was one of my favorite ones. And you know why? He goes, "Well, Mr. Disney was standing behind the cameraman as I was filming this, and he was smoking a cigarette. And every time I see that picture, I just see Walt Disney standing there killing himself smoking." So I found it to be a very touching moment how, you know, one thing affects me as a real positive situation. Somebody else gets a totally different view. But Fess was a great guy. I worked with him on a number of occasions. He was a pilot. I was a pilot. When we were there in Chicago, my dad flew in for the weekend. And Fess and I sat in the bar and talking airplanes. At the end of the night, he told me what a thrill it had been for him to talk about something other than that darn coonskin cap. So Mr. Parker was as nice in person, or he was everything you would want your heroes to be, and just a super outstanding guy. So Crockett Mania hits. Everybody wants a piece of Davy Crockett. You could not buy anything without Davy Crockett on it, seems. So you could get here your Davy Crockett magic slate. You had comic books. You had cardboard figures, things that you could get, all sorts of stuff. So they keep going on. Davy Crockett's been a hit. It's going on. And we're going to come up with the next one, Davy Crockett Goes to Congress. We have a rifle shoot here with Mike Mazurki, a great, great character actor who was a great villain in all these things. And they're getting ready to do a shoot. And we find out how good Georgie and Davy are compared to him. And then he goes off to Congress. And as I mentioned, he became a fan of the Indians, a supporter of them, got to understand, and we'll see more in this video clip. Oh, I just want to pause this 1 second. One of the other things that made a big, big difference in the Disney shows was the use of matte paintings. For folks that are not familiar with it, a matte painting is done on a piece of glass, and insert it over the exposed film to extend the scene. So matte paintings are used widely back in those days in Hollywood movies. Today they all do with CGI, but back then it was a big thing, but nobody did it for television. It's an expensive thing to do because you have to pay an artist to do it. You have to do extra camera work, setting up your shots, optical work and everything. But just in this one quick shot, there was at the very beginning, a quick matte shot, but look how many times they extend the picture through matte painting. The village doesn't exist in your mind. Looks suspiciously like Southern California, doesn't it? Washington, D.C., matte painting. Riding up to a matte painting.
Haven't you been able to force the vote yet? The opposition won't yield the floor. Get them to call that vote. Why, Davy, I didn't expect you back for a week.
I know.
Now, Davy, if you're worried about the Indian bill, it's all over. They've already passed it.
They'll have to change their minds.
I'm warning you, Crockett. Go in there and you're committing political suicide.
You know what I think about your kind of politics?
I yield to the gentleman from Tennessee.
And he goes on to get them to undo the bill that they were trying to do to take away even more of the Indian lands. So they come up to the next one, Davy Crockett at the Alamo. Great shot here showing it on the soundstage. You can see how large these sets are. And at the end of Davy.
Give one for Davy.
As long as we remember the Alamo. Davy, Davy Crockett and Crockett's company. Davy, Davy Crockett, fighting for liberty.
So, more Davy Crockett merchandise keeps coming out. This is a great playset. If you ever have a lot of money and you want to get a great toy. This Marx Brothers set was really great. I remember having it as a kid, unfortunately long gone. But now they got this problem. They've just killed off Davy. It was the biggest overnight hit in TV history. They have all sorts of merchandise and everything is going on and everybody's wanting more Crockett and Davy's dead, right? So what do they do now? This is Walt. He didn't want to go back and bring Davy back from the dead. Everybody knew he died at the Alamo. So what do you do at that point? You've told Davy his rising to fame, his great feats and deeds, and he's dead. Well, you come up with the idea of doing something else that takes the actors and maybe you can get them together. So this was a TV show that they got in the script phase on it and decided that they would go into a different direction. Again, Big Bill Williams never became famous like that. So Walt invented something new, the prequel. I mean, we all talk about so many famous firsts that Walt did for sound cartoon and stereo and all that. But when we have prequels today on TV, you can thank it for Walt. And he came up with probably my favorite two shows of the anthology series, Davy Crockett and Keelboat Race and the River Pirates. And just a great show. I love Mike York, or Jeff York here rather, as Mike Fink. And again, done on location, all shot in color. They were great shows and really, really successful. So we have the River Pirates, shot again out along the river. You can still go to the cave where the River Pirates were. They had their epic battles. And they said, okay, Davy's a big hit. So we let's do something more with him. How do we keep going? So for the next year, they thought, okay, Mike Fink was a big enough character. Maybe we go and spin him off and do a whole separate series about him. And we'll go and try to do some more Davy Crockett episodes, more of the prequel. They even looked down at the bottom, if you see, they were thinking about doing a series of Tommy Kirk as young Davy Crockett. So they got all these things in process, and then Walt came to the realization that he had taken the Davy Crockett TV shows, and they reran them, and every time he reran them, the ratings were higher than when it first ran. So he then put it out as a theatrical feature, and it was at first just going to go overseas, but they decided, try it in the United States. We've already made it. How much could it cost us? They were making a fortune with people going out to the movies to see Davy Crockett, which has already aired 2-3 times on television for free. And people are going out to pay money to watch it because now the thing was they could see Davy in color. So Walt came to the idea that, hey, Fess Barker's quite a name draw. I can make a lot of money with him in the movies, and we'll see some of the movies coming up. But let's take Fess off television, and let's put him in movies. So let's see what else we can do with television. So they came up with another Western character, the Saga of Andy Burnett. There were 6 of these episodes done, and started filling in Jerome Cortland. Jerry was a really nice guy. He was still working as a producer at the studio when I got there. He was a pilot, real big into sailplanes, and managed to work them into some of the productions he did. I didn't have my pilot's license at the time, but spent some time talking to Jerry. He was a really great guy. Didn't have a huge television career on screen. I thought the Andy Burnett shows were pretty good. They didn't hold a candle to Davy, of course. But I thought they were pretty good shows. And he was a very nice fellow to chat with. So they were, at that time, having 2 big stars. You had the Saga of Andy Burnett and Zorro. And they've taken a publicity photo here.
The trails opened up the land.
I'll see a little bit
Andy
of Andy
gave
here.
America a mighty helping hand. Andy's on the move, Andy won't rest. Andy Burnett, he's a traveling west.
And now your host, Walt Disney.
Maps like these have always held a great fascination for me, and I've been collecting them for many years. I think the secret of this fascination is that an old map tells a wonderful story of a people and a time in history. The kind of storyteller can tell. Stuart Edward White was such a master of the storyteller's art. And a whole generation of Americans grew up with his stories. His wonderful wilderness novels, one after another, ran serially in their most popular magazines. And his books of adventure in the out-of-doors filled their bookshelves. As you can see, this was all not so very long ago. For his crowning work, The Saga of Andy Burnett, was not published in its entirety until 1947. In both magazine and book form, this epic novel created a legion of Andy Burnett fans whose loyalty remains as keen today as when they first read these exciting adventures of a young man on the frontiers of a young America. It is this story, an entirely new kind of story of the American West, never before told on television or in motion pictures, that we bring you now. For the next 3 weeks, a group of 3 adventures from the Saga of Andy Burnett. And from time to time, there'll be other such groups until the whole great story is told. Now, let's turn back from our familiar America to the America of our fathers, and then further back to Andy's America and the Saga of Andy Burnett.
Andy's on the move, Andy won't rest. Andy Burnett, he's a traveling west. The times are gone that he once knew. Endless woods and the sky so blue, the trails no man had trod before, the wilderness at the cabin door, the urge to know where the rivers flow, the freedom to up and pack and go. Lucky for us, a few men yet remember the saga of Andy Burnett. Andy made the trails, opened up the land, Andy gave America a mighty helping hand. Andy's on the move, Andy won't rest. Andy Burnett, he's a traveling west.
And the sarsaparilla ain't too...
And sarsaparilla is not too tough for you. It's interesting. If you watch this, look how carefully they were trying to recreate the Disney, the Davy Crockett success. You have the, not animation, but artwork in the beginning, a long theme song, everything. So they really tried to go out of their way, but sometimes, lightning doesn't strike twice. They also gave it the whole merchandising treatment, so you could buy your Andy Burnett books, you could get your Andy Burnett coloring books. The shows are kind of good, but again, Andy was on a 10 scale, he was maybe a 7. You know, he was low-key, not as homespun as Fess Parker version of Davy Crockett. So they're good shows, but they didn't just hold a candle to it. Early, we saw the picture of Guy Williams. Zorro was obviously a big issue, again, the western side of the country. The two seasons they did, and then the 4-hour episodes. I've done other talks on Zorro, so we won't be covering him in depth today, but you can imagine that the success Disney was having at this point in time on television. You just had the whole Davy Crockett mania. Now you release Zorro. Zorro mania was even bigger in terms of merchandise. They were really on a roll. So great, great series. One of my all-time favorites. And again, if you want any more information on Zorro, you can go to BillCotter.com/Zorro and spend a whole bunch of time following the mark of the Z. So then comes along, okay, famous quote from Walt. Okay, you want Westerns, you're going to have Westerns. He wanted to do other things, but ABC wanted Westerns. There were so many of them on television at that point in time, on all the other networks, that I'd say television Westerns probably, probably a good 70% at times of some of the network schedules. So there's a famous story where Walt walks in and he's wearing two six-shooters and a 10-gallon hat. And he comes in and says, okay, you want Westerns? I'll give you Westerns. And then here's what they started coming up with. So for the 1958-59 season, he was going to come up with John Slaughter, Outlaw Hater. We're going to see much more of Texas John Slaughter. Elfego Baca was just going to be a quick little throwaway. They did the movie Comanche, then planned it as a TV show, and said it came out theatrically, made a good mark there. And they had others that we never saw. We never saw the stories of Marcus Whitman or Pete Kitchen or any of these, but this was just an idea for one season, how heavy the studio was looking into going into Westerns. Elfego Baca, instead of having just 2 episodes, came down to have all 10. Robert Loggia, great actor. I had some great conversations with him, and he was so happy with what Walt did starting his career. But if you ever get a chance to watch them, they're all pretty good, but go and watch episode number 10, Gus Tomlin is Dead. It's a really interesting story where Elfego goes off to look for Gus Tomlin, and he goes into a town, he had committed some crime, and they wanted to bring him back for justice. And he goes to a town, and he meets the blacksmith there, who's played by Alan Hale Jr. of Gilligan's Island fame. And I won't ruin it for you. He has to make a big decision on what he does when he discovers that Gus Tomlin is really not dead. And does he do the right thing, or does he do the better right thing? Great show. Really very much not a usual, shoot 'em up, bang, bang Western at the time. Now, to do these shows, they needed to create a back lot. They couldn't afford to keep going and doing all these shows out on location like they had done with Crockett. So they built a back lot. This was part of the Zorro set that was originally built at Pueblo de Los Angeles. Here, I think it had been redressed for Monkeys Go Home. But they built quite a Western street. You can see some of the buildings here. They went off at the different angles, so you never saw that it was just a short little street. These streets were also there when I started there in 76. Unfortunately, they've all since been torn down. But it was great because they were doing movies when I was there, like the Apple Dumpling Gang and others. And, they'd dress them all up with the saloon signs and the dance hall girls and, merchandise out in front of the shops and horses up and down the streets. And the days they weren't shooting, it was just a peaceful spot to go and walk around the back lot. A fellow named Lou Debney, I mentioned in my Zorro talk, he was a great guy to know, and we'd walk around the back lot, and he would just have all these great memories. I remember we did this, and so and such fell off the horse, and you know, knocked himself out, and we had to go and get somebody to double for him. And, you know, it's just great to be there at the right time when the old timers were still around. So Western Streets here were also redressed for movies like Toby Tyler, 10 Weeks at the Circus. They would make it a Midwestern town as opposed to a Western town. Great, great back lot. So Elfego Baca, again, famous people that actually lived. Elfego was a gunfighter that became a sheriff, that became a lawyer, and was actually a real life person. In the 1960s, we went to, actually the 70s rather, I went to a meeting with Ron Miller, head of the Disney studio, and they were talking how they were thinking about bringing back some of these shows, doing new versions of it to run on the anthology series. And there was a talk, do we take some of the old episodes, run those as the prequel, and do something for today? By this time, some of the people like Robert Loggia had become maybe a little too famous. You know, his budget might have been a little too hard, but maybe he could have gotten them back. But the shows had a higher level of violence when they're shot in the 50s and 60s than was acceptable just 10 years later in the 70s. And Ron talked about shots like this when they did a screening for the NBC executives. He said they almost had a heart attack, shooting a man and shooting him in the back. By this time, standards and practices had come up with the rule that I could show somebody shooting, I could show somebody getting shot, but I couldn't show it in the same shot. So if they shot this today, you'd have to have the guy with the gun shooting. You then go to a close-up of Robert Loggia reacting, and then he falls down. But you couldn't do the shot and the victim all in one. So they did not end up bringing Elfego back. But we're going to have a quick look at the Elfego.
Disney presents from Frontierland, The Nine Lives of Elfego Baca. Elfego Baca, the man who couldn't be killed. Bullets. That's a lot of lead, isn't it? The man whose story you're about to see actually held off a lynch mob of 80 cowboys who fired 4,000 rounds like this into the flimsy shack where he was hiding. He came out of it without a scratch. And miraculously, so did the statue of Santa Anna that shared the siege with him. His name was
Elfego Baca, in the land of big men, when this great west was wild, Elfego was small and his nature was mild. And the legend was that, like Elgato the cat, nine lives had Elfego, Elgato. He dared to stand up to the toughest of men. He faced all their six guns again and again. All the people in town and the folks all around sing the praise of Elfego, Elgato. Elfego was wise and Elfego was strong. Elfego, Elgato, who made right from wrong. And the legend was that, like Elgato the cat, nine lives at Elfego Baca.
Elfego Baca, light-hearted adventurer and lightning-fast gunfighter, but always on the side of justice. The Mexican-Americans, whose rights he always defended, called him the man who could not be killed. This is the first of several adventures titled The Nine Lives of Elfego Baca.
Nine lives had Elfego Baca. Nine lives had Elfego Baca.
It's interesting when you listen to the song they're singing about the legends of Elfego, the cat. Years later, Robert Loggia starred in a TV series called THE Cat about basically a private investigator, sort of like an American version of The Saint. And when I was talking to him, I asked if that was any coincidence, and he said, "Yeah, it was total coincidence. The producers of that show had come up with it, and I said, and once again, I'm the cat, but I was a totally different one." Great guy to talk to. You might have noticed a little different tie that Walt was wearing in that introduction. So the tie from the Smoke Tree Ranch. There's a symbol on it. This was Walt's property out in Palm Springs. He owned several properties over the years. The first one he had sold off to help pay for the building of Disneyland, the park. And when the park started becoming successful and the TV shows and everything were running, he went and bought another property out there. And he wears that smoke tree tie, not necessarily the short one, but a smoke tree tie in many, many of his introductions. Again, just, I think, connecting him back to what was important to him. Then we come up with Texas John Slaughter. There were so many episodes, I can't fit them all on one screen. You can see down here that we have episodes 7 and 7A. And, why did they do that? Well, originally they were thinking of doing a two-hour episode, but then the network said, no, we don't want to do a two-hour, so split it in half. So we end up with episode 7A. And we end up with 17 episodes in total. So Texas John Slaughter, the longest running of the Disney Westerns, starred Tom Tryon, a very intense actor at the time, who was really good as Texas John Slaughter. If you've seen him in some other things, Disney put him in Moon Pilot, a comedy. I thought he was kind of wasted in that. But he later got out of acting, became a very, very well-known novelist, and had a very successful career after his acting days. But for Texas John Slaughter, he was really good. He here is a member of the Texas Rangers, matter of fact, a whole bunch of them with their white hats. Just off to his left is Harry Carey Jr., you may remember from The Adventures of Spin and Marty. Very other character actors you see in all sorts of Westerns, but Texas John had to deal with all sorts of issues. He had Indians that were after him. His wife didn't want him becoming a gunfighter or a Texas Ranger. All of a sudden wives die and all sorts of odds and ends. So they brought in some guest stars. We see Dwayne Hickman here, Dobie Gillis. We'll take a look at Texas John.
With Stetsons all white and a pearl-handled gun swinging on his side. Texas John Slaughter made them do what they order, 'cause if they didn't, they died.
A turned-up white Stetson and a pearl-handled gun. My friend Stan Jones has written a song about them. I want you to hear it. Stan?
His turned-up white Stetson and pearl-handled gun were known both far and wide. With Stetson so white and a pearl-handled gun swinging on his side. Texas John Slaughter made them do what they order, 'cause if they didn't, they died. In Texas, a ranger he had to become, and outlaws he defied. Oh, Texas John Slaughter made them do what they order, 'cause if they didn't, they died. His turned-up white Stetson and pearl-handled gun were known both far and wide. We're known both far and wide.
John Slaughter, a true hero of the West.
Now that's for sure, Walt. You know, he was a co-founder of Douglas, Arizona, my hometown. You know something else? When I was born, he was at my christening.
Is that right? You know, I have a personal interest in John Slaughter, too. Our research department discovered that when Mrs. Slaughter died in 1942, among her personal effects were 100 shares of Walt Disney production stock.
Well, what do you know?
That just goes to show that this old West that we talk about is not so old after all.
That's right.
It's only yesterday in this young country of ours. Yes, John Slaughter was quite a man. Our song says, he made men do what they oughter, 'cause if they didn't, they died. Well, that's the songwriter's way of saying that John Slaughter used his six guns to establish law and order in this young country of ours. Now, in the first of this series of programs about this great man of the West, you'll see how he became a Texas Ranger. It's titled Texas John Slaughter.
Now, anybody, I'm open for argument about this, but isn't Walt just the best damn television host ever invented? I mean, that stuff I could just watch for hours. I mean, just incredible. So they did the Texas John Slaughter shows, and they then decided that they would start releasing them overseas. A couple of them actually have come out on home video here in the States back in the VHS days. But they were a big hit, so they've released a number of them, compilations of the movies out there. And he also got the merchandising treatment, Texas John Slaughter, comic books. You get, here's one combining him and Elfego Baca. Just all sorts of stuff put together. They even did Texas John Slaughter comic books overseas. So this one was from Australia. Record albums, again, we just saw Stan Jones singing the song there, so they didn't have Tom do it, they had Stan do it. But they also put out record albums, compilations, and this particular one has the words to it. And I have to say, my daughter is probably one of the few kids that's gotten herself, when she was an infant, being rocked to sleep with the lyrics, Texas John Slaughter made men do what they ought to, because if they didn't, they died. I mean, I just had an amazing piece of music. Going on to another Disney hero, the Swamp Fox. Again, this hero of the Revolutionary War. The boundary of the country moves back and forth, and so does our little narrative here. But we ended up with 8 stories of the Swamp Fox, starring Leslie Nielsen. And this was way, way before his Airplane days or Police Squad or anything else. He was thought to be a pretty serious actor. It turns out Leslie had a heck of a sense of humor. He worked with anybody that worked with him. He liked to hide whoopee cushions on the set. So people would sit down and go do a scene and they'd ruin it because he sat on a whoopee cushion. So there's all sorts of stories about him and whoopee cushions. We'll take for another time. But he, I thought, was, again, just really great. I love the Swamp Fox stories. Again, try to come up with Davy Crockett. You know, he had a coonskin cap. Well, here you got Swamp Fox, feather in his hat. No one knows where the Swamp Fox at. But we'll take a look at some of the Swamp Fox.
In the spring of 1780, when Colonel Francis Marion first came to prominence, America's war for independence seemed all but lost. Washington's hard-pressed army was deteriorating in New Jersey, waiting for reinforcements from General Lafayette. But the French were bottled up by a British fleet standing off the mouth of Narragansett Bay. Down at Charleston, General Lincoln and his colonial army faced imminent attack by land and sea, and royal garrisons had already been established along the Carolina frontier from Rocky Mount to the Atlantic. Along this line, it was the enemy's plan to divide the colonies and conquer them one part at a time. Suddenly, to the surprise of Cornwallis, his communications were cut, his supply trains were intercepted, and isolated outpost garrisons were destroyed. In this darkest hour of his country's need, the Swamp Fox had been born. And he and his hardy band of freedom fighters were on the move. To the American patriots who lived and fought throughout those uncertain days, Colonel Marion was a hero second only to George Washington. Even after the fighting ended and our new nation began to expand westward, the legend of the Swamp Fox was told and retold around 1,000 campfires. The result today is that there are 17 counties and 29 cities and towns scattered throughout the United States that proudly bear the name of Marion. Now, this is the first of several stories we will bring you about the daring adventures of America's Robin Hood of the Revolution, the Swamp Fox. Its title, The Birth of the Swamp Fox.
Again, great, great episodes. Now, it's interesting, they did these right around here. Again, the hills of California look suspiciously like the hills of Georgia here, don't they? So, but they spent a lot of money on doing all these things off the back lot, different locations. You see how complicated it is just for a simple scene of four guys sitting on horses chatting. Look at the size of the crews you have to bring out on location. These massive lights, the carbon arc lights they were using at the time, the sun reflector shades, everything. So, it was not cheap to do these shows, and they didn't stint on them. You know, rather than just having two guys on horses, have four guys. It costs more horses, more handlers, all the ones in the background and everything, but it really comes through on the screen. This is an interesting one here. The British have been stripped of their uniforms, although they seem to leave them with their hats. And don't know if you can see on the screen, the soldier in the front, the lieutenant who's telling his commander that the Swamp Fox got the better of them was Patrick McNee, who later became famous as John Steed from the TV show The Avengers. I had sent Mr. McNee a copy of the picture, asking him to autograph it for me, and asked if he had a copy of the show if he wanted it. And to my delight, he wrote back and said, no, he'd love to see a copy of the show. I sent it to him. He sent me copies of a book of poetry his wife wrote. And we ended up with a very nice pen pal exchange, went on for a number of years. So The Avengers being one of my top favorite shows, it was just a thrill to make an acquaintance with him. The merchandise machine also went crazy. Swamp Fox games, comic books, you could buy Swamp Fox hats, coloring books, records, all sorts of things. He's jumped back in with Zorro. He did the 4 one-hour episodes. He had taken the show off the air in a battle with ABC, but they were willing to pay him a fortune to bring it back for 4 more Westerns to the Hour anthology series, so he did those episodes. He also said, let's try another one with Daniel Boone. We had some success with Davy Crockett and minor success with Dewey Martin in his shows. So let's see if we can bring Daniel Boone onto the air. So I got a fellow named Dewey Martin, and Dewey was a great actor for doing Daniel Boone, but he wasn't a Davy, Fess Parker, who Fess did his own version of Daniel Boone, not a non-Disney show. A woman here, Mala Powers, played his wife. And they had the whole thing of setting out west. Some great character actors, Slim Pickens and others in there.
Down through the ages, man has been impelled for one reason or another to break away from the established order of things and push beyond the boundaries of civilization to find out what was on the other side of the mountain or the other side of the sea. The Norsemen set out for conquest. Columbus to prove a theory, Heinrich Hudson to find the Northwest Passage, and now our modern astronauts to find out not what's on the other side of the mountain, but on the other side of the moon. These men were and are the trailblazers, the first to venture into the realm of the unknown in their respective fields. Here in America, we've had many famous trailblazers, Ponce de Leon, Cortez, LaSalle, Lewis and Clark. But perhaps the most famous trailblazer of them all was Dan'l Boone, the hero of our adventure series based on the life of the famous frontiersman. In 1753, the whole of the Ohio River Valley was an unexplored wilderness, which no white man had seen. The Indians called it King Tuck, and rumors of its fertility and abundance of game drifted back to the ears of young Boone in North Carolina, and so excited his imagination, he had to see it. Now, Dan'l didn't need much encouragement. A born hunter-trapper with an itchy foot, he needed plenty of elbow room, and it was getting crowded in Yadkin Valley. Why, he complained on a clear day he could see the chimney smoke of his nearest neighbor some 6 miles away. So, with his famous tick-licker rifle, Boone headed west. In our opening story, you will see how this restless adventure was led into the fabled land of Kentuck, sacred hunting grounds of the Indians, by an old trader who had discovered their secret passage through the mountains. The Indians called it the Warrior's Path, and that's the title of this story.
So those shows ran for a number of years, but they were far eclipsed by the Fess Parker show. They did another one coming near the end of Walt's life and near the end of his Westerns, Johnny Shiloh, starring Kevin Corcoran. was interesting. I was at an event at the Disney Studios, and I was talking to Kevin. This was both after he and I had been there when we worked there together, but this was years later. They were dedicating a stage to Annette Funicello, and I happened to be talking to Kevin. And I asked him what, of all the Disney TV and movies he had done, what was his favorite show? And he said, Johnny Shiloh. And his wife turned around and said, you never told me that. And he goes, well, you never asked me. So I found that humorous. But Johnny Shiloh was a great piece of film. We're going to see a clip from that coming up.
Johnny Clem was the name of a lad not in his teens when the war between the states had begun. But the name Johnny won with his drum and his gun will live in history. Johnny Shiloh, Johnny Shiloh, that ought to be in Mr. Lincoln's army. Johnny Shiloh, bravest Yankee drummer boy, Johnny Shiloh, Johnny Shiloh.
To show how things had changed, that grassy berm area they were just running in front was actually on the studio back lot in beautiful downtown Burbank. So, no filming out on a location if you can avoid it by this point in time. The costs were just too high for what television was paying. But Johnny got some merchandising treatment, a comic book and that. And it was also released as a theatrical movie, so it did well. Another show they did, The Tenderfoot, starred a fellow named Brandon DeWild, a three-parter about him going out and a guy from the city who had just read novels and thought it would be fun to go out and become a cowboy, and just how different what they told you in the books are from reality. Co-starred Richard Long, later became the big star in The Big Valley. Then they came up with a series that Walt seemed to be very, very proud of, Gallagher. You can see how many episodes they did here. The first one was just Gallagher, part 1, 2, and 3. They didn't have episode titles. But then for the others, they came up with different names for them. I think Gallagher may have appealed to Walt, as maybe a little bit of Walter Mitty type syndrome, a kid on the West. And Gallagher, by the way, was addicted to dime novels, so maybe Walt some sort of connection with that. But they're really good shows if you get a chance to watch them. They starred a fellow named Roger Mobley. And we'll take a look at some Gallagher.
Gallagher. Gallagher.
Gallagher.
Gallagher.
Gallagher.
Oh, Gallagher. Gallagher. Wearing out his shoes. Nosing around for who.
How do you do? The story we are about to bring you takes place during that great and colorful era known as the gay 90s. It's a newspaper story, and it was written by a newspaper man, Richard Harding Davis, who has long been regarded as the greatest war correspondent of all time.
Next.
But it was this story that made Davis famous as a writer of fiction. It was always his favorite, and it has long been one of ours. The hero is a newspaper copy boy by the name of, Mulligan, Hannigan, Flanagan.
Gallagher.
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 Oh, Gallagher. Gallagher. Running down the street after another newsbeat. Gallagher. Gallagher.
nosing around for news.
He'd follow up a story no matter where it led.
Unafraid, he made the grade where others feared to tread.
No slicker could out-trick him. No one was quicker than
that sharp as a thorn. Natural.
Thanks, fellas. You took the words right out of my mouth. Now let's meet Gallagher.
If folks may have recognized, the last guy singing there was Thurl Ravenscroft, the voice of Tony the Tiger, and also one of the famous singing faces in the Haunted Mansion. So again, the merchandise machine goes clicking along and turning these things out. Then we come near the end. Again, big superstar today. Kurt Russell was in the TV thing, another one about the Civil War, Will and the Yank. Here, a publicity photo, Peggy Lipton, who was soared to fame in the Mod Squad, and James MacArthur, who had been in so many great things for Disney in the movies. So again, they take some of these things out and they put it out as movies. Overseas, they decided to release this with the title Mosby's Marauders. And it was done as a co-feature with Monkeys Go Home. And that's basically the end of the TV side of it. But just make a quick mention of some of the movies that they did, so many of them. Again, they'd taken Fess and moved him out of the TV world into the theatrical world. And he was as big a hit in the theatrical side for Disney as he had been in television. So starred in some of my all-time favorites. I just absolutely adore The Great Locomotive Chase. We had a great presentation Beth did for us on that a while back. Walt out here on location, you can see he's got one of his little period ties out there. Westward Hold the Wagons. Then he wasn't their only Western star. Again, the frontier was shifted way back to Boston at this point, but again, stories of America growing up, Johnny Tremaine. Old Yeller, the heart, tearing story that everybody knows about. Light in the Forest is a really great movie if you get a chance to see it. Unfortunately, it's not on any of the Disney services, and it's very hard to come across, but a good movie to see. Tonka, again, Sal Mineo, this was going to be done as a TV show, and they decided to put it out as a theatrical. Toby Tyler, I get a kick out of this one, not just because Henry Calvin on the right, his character's name was Ben Cotter, so I always get a kick out of that, but some great, great footage of the back lot and that in a great movie. Ten Who Dared, going down the Colorado River and shot on location, a tremendously, tremendously hard movie to film, particularly with the film gear of the 1959 era or so when they shot it. But a great movie if you get a chance to see it. It's really outstanding. Savage Sam, a sequel to Old Yeller, was interesting. I was originally putting this presentation together for the Disney Family Museum, and they didn't like the name Savage Sam because they thought it was, talking about a savage Indian. And I had to convince them, no, Sam was the dog, so we could use it. But let's look back. Like I said, I ended up the Walt years. Walt here with the train he helped build himself, and we can still see today. But Walt had a tremendous affinity for the American West and the stories that shaped the nation. And I hope that gave you a look back at some of them. So let me stop the share here. And I'm sure there's a few questions in here. Folks can take themselves off of mute. You just need to hold the space bar down and chat, or you can put up your hand if you want to do it and I can call on you. But as I go back through a whole long list of questions here, any comments, observations, or anything?
I've met Fess Parker several times out of Disneyland, and he had to have been one of the nicest guys. He was in the Disneyland 35th anniversary, and he was in a little cart going up the street, and I was standing there and wanted to take his picture, and he posed for me. He was so kind. And then I met him later and got his autograph. He had to be one of the nicest guys. He really was.
Yeah, he was. When we were, we did this thing where they flew me, Fess, and Dave Smith, the Disney archivist, back to Chicago to open a museum at the Museum of Broadcast Communications and do a thing on the 100 best hours of Disney television. And so I got to spend a lot of time with Fess that weekend. Then I did some other panels with him and other things. But, you know, we'd be sitting there talking and somebody would come up and, you know, want to get an autograph. And he was always polite and, you know, and he'd be right in the middle of telling something, you know, and somebody would just walk up rudely, interrupt him. He was, oh, okay. Just one second before I lose my thought. And then he'd sign it. I tell you, it was one of the high points of my life sitting there watching my dad, you know, who I absolutely adore, and Fess Parker, who was like a television hero, watching my dad and Fess Parker just sitting there laughing like they had been old friends for the best of their lives. And we'd only known each other for a couple hours. He was just, you know, you work in the industry long enough, you realize a lot of the talent are people you don't want to be around. And then you run into a Fess Parker and it's a whole different universe.
Yes, he was lovely.
Yeah, Carlos asked for that Walt's actual office. No, it wasn't. We saw several different Walt offices on this, and they were all done on a soundstage. So the first one where we saw, he's in what looks like a library setting. They would basically go over to Walt's office, his real office. He had two of them, a formal office and a working office in the animation building up on the third floor. And they would take out certain props that he'd like to have around him, go and put it on the movie stage set. Do the intros and then put everything back again. So again, when I started there in 76, you could talk to the people that worked on it. And one of the guys who was hanging pictures in my office for me was one of the guys that used to carry everything back and forth between the sets and everything. He said he was scared to death of dropping anything. You know, you think about carrying, you know, nitro across the Andes or something. He says, you're taking Walt's knickknack off his desk and you have to move it over there. And he says, every time he put it back on the desk, and he said he doesn't think Walt would fire him, but he didn't ever want to find out. So fun stuff. Just
right here. Wasn't Zorro a weekly TV series for a while?
Yeah, they did 78 episodes, 39 each of two seasons of it. And then he got into a war with ABC. They were buying ABC out of the theme park investment. The ABC was also arguing that they owned Zorro, so they should be getting a set of the merchandise money, which Walt did not want to give him. So while they were having a fight, he pulled Zorro off the air. Highest rated show out there at the height of his career, and he just pulled it off. So he was using his bargaining negotiations with ABC. He kept Guy Williams on the contract. He had him do like The Prince and the Pauper. And then ABC came back and said, you know, we'll stop our battle about Zorro. Could you bring him back? So they brought him back for 4 one-hour episodes on the anthology series. And then by that time, the, you know, all bubbles burst. You know, you could see, you know, Western. So all of a sudden, everybody's got a Western, and now let's go do crime shows. So crime shows go. Everybody's got one of those. Let's do a medical show. You know, so, you know, the whole industry is ups and downs like that. By that point, yeah, that was the end of Zorro. They later came back, and you can go on the Zoom and watch it. Did the whole thing on Zorro. They brought it back as Zorro and Son, a sitcom, which the less said about the better. Absolutely dreadful thing. So, yeah, and again, another thing about Walt's office. It's interesting because I was able to talk to a fellow that did a lot of Walt's introductions. And I mentioned earlier, sort of spontaneously, Walt was just, to me, the best host. I mean, he, you'd see that he really believed and loved in his product. But Jack Spears, this writer, would talk about how Walt had certain words he couldn't pronounce, like the word aluminum, he could not pronounce, which was really bad because Reynolds Aluminum was one of his sponsors. So Jack would occasionally just put words in there that Walt would change. And it's like that, you know, they always say, if you have something that you're really proud about, but you know your boss is going to change something for the sake of it, put something else in there so he doesn't touch the stuff you're really proud about. So Jack would say, he would put something in there that Walt would say, I don't like that. And he'd get all flustered about this and change that and just leave the rest of it alone. But one day, Jack decided he'd have some fun. So he wrote a absolutely near unpronounceable, incomprehensible script to one of the openings and gave it to Walt. And Walt tried it and tried it and tried it and just exploded. You know, who wrote this piece of crap? And Jack was, oh, I had another one in case you needed it. And he said he never, ever, ever to the final day ever admitted to Walt he had done it on purpose. But he said it was a very fun day to be on the set washing. So, but, and then they had the TV, you saw the set where, you know, the Sons of the Pioneers or the Mellow Man, everybody is singing. They built other sets besides his fake office. His fake office was kind of interesting because I don't think I saw in any of the scenes that we showed today, but he'd be at his office and you see out the window is a picture of the animation building, which in reality, his office was at the top of the animation building. So a little bit of Hollywood licensing there. Yeah, Brian mentioned George Burns was a genius, absolutely. There were so many of the composers that were there. I had the pleasure one time of being at lunch with Buddy Baker on one side of me and Tommy Kirk on the other. And it was like, oh, who do I speak to? You know, I mean, luckily it was a real long lunch, but these guys were really great on the stuff that they did. And, you know, like I said, the fact that so many songs are burned into our memories. Carolyn mentioned just thinking today's shows would never have that long lead-in content. You think back then you had the show would come on, you'd have a minute of just the titles. Every week we bring to you from this land, you know, Fantasyland, the Frontierland, you know, all that. So that's all long. Then you get Walt talking and the song, everything. Today, you know, 20 seconds of, you know, credits, maybe some theme music and right into the show. So everything is changed, you know.
Walt always threw in a lot of history in that introduction too.
Yeah.
He always told you about what was going on in the history of that period. I thought that was great.
Yeah. Caleb mentioned he worked on a 2019 CD of George Burns music for Johnny Tremaine. Wonderful project, Caleb. Thanks a lot for helping bring that out. I as soon as I saw it was coming out, I went off and bought it. I have it on my iPod and pops up in the car from time to time. And it's just really great that some of these things, you know, Disney has saved so much of this stuff, but I imagine that was a hard one to convince them. Who remembers the movie Johnny Tremaine? You know, it's not a big soundtrack like Raiders of the Lost Ark, but it's a, you know, great to get it out there. I just wish they were more than them. Tom Morris mentioned two Walt sets, stage one Walt's office and the other Walt's library. Thanks, Tom. He actually had a couple of different ones over the years. There's another one of my favorite Walt intros when he's doing The Prince and the Pauper, where he's in a library and it's this very modernized, stylized set where it looks like he goes off to infinity. And Walt is out there talking about, what are the odds of somebody looking just like somebody else? And, you know, the thought that there could be somebody like, and then all of a sudden another Walt walks on the stage and says, are you doing this again? You know, I told you to stop doing it. And the fake, supposed fake Walt walks off. Absolutely great, great bit. Like I said, his intros to me were absolutely wonderful. I just, you know, just to me, they were sometimes, when I did a panel discussion down at Disneyland years ago, somebody asked about, you know, the Walt shows. And I mentioned how I didn't really like a lot of the boy and his dog shows. My dad did, but, you know, there was the boy and his eagle and the boy and his dog and the boy and his seal and his hawk and everything else. And I watched them every week because I didn't want to let Uncle Walt down. And I loved the intros and the rest of it I would kind of tune out. And Diane Disney Miller came over later and just thanked me profusely for saying so many nice things about her dad. And, you know, again, I just love the Walt years. I'm absolutely super fan. Carolyn, I thought his office looked so clean. Yeah, well, his office was always clean. So he had several secretaries would come and clean it up for him. So we talked about the jobs of being a Walt secretary a few weeks ago with the state I found up in Cal Arts. Tom added the Western streets were designed by Stan Jolly, who was from the WID staff at the studio. Tom, anything you'd like to add about any of the Westerns? I know that you you know a lot about the back lot and those sort of things.
Stan Jolly he was on the WED staff as a draftsman and quickly became an assistant art director under Marvin Davis, whose name you might recognize as the master planner of Disneyland. Mm-hmm. So you often hear that somewhat falsely that to design Disneyland, Walt turned to his team of set designers and backlot designers to select his Imagineers from, but there was no backlot in 1954. and so it's actually the opposite. The backlots, the Zorro sets were designed by Marvin Davis, and the Western Street was Stan Jolly under the supervision of Marvin Davis. And the residential street was Carol Clark, whose name I saw flash by. Mm-hmm. And so that's that on the, the people behind the backlots were, partly Imagineers. And mm-hmm. in the case of Carol Clark, he went on to be the art director of Mary Poppins, among other films.
Yeah, I mean, the back lot was fun to walk around, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I feel that all that old weathered wood had just soaked up so much atmosphere.
A lot of people would have would eat their lunch on the porch, Summer Magic porch. That was a thing to do.
Where was the back lot built?
It's gone now, but it was in the Disney Studios. The main entrance is on Buena Vista, and literally on the back side of the lot, I think it was Empire Street or something like that, was the Western Street. So at the far end of it, you had the Zorro Quartels, and then you had the Western Streets that went along, and then it went into the Midwestern town, where they did like Tom just mentioned, Summer Magic. There was just a discussion going on the Facebook about somebody finding some of the sets or whatever in Summer Magic. But they would come around into the small town street where they did so many things like Follow Me Boys and that. And then you had a couple residential houses. You had the house and the absent-minded professor and the shaggy dog and everything. And then the big yellow house from Summer Magic. And some of these houses had interiors that basically were just empty rooms. The Summer Magic house was about that deep or something. But it had these old wicker chairs out in the front. And my office, I had three different offices, but one of them was in the ink and paint building. And we had what was called the tea room that all the ink and paint ladies used to go up there and get their ice creams and that. And this wonderful woman named Frances she'd make you a hot fudge sundae or a chocolate ice cream soda. They also brought in these great things called tea cakes from Marino's Bakery and Martino's. And then we'd take our ice cream, we'd walk down, there was a patio outside, walk down the patio across the street and sit on the front porch of the Summer Magic House eating ice cream cones. I mean, it was just the coolest place to work. And you see the movie today and go, that's me and my ice cream cone. So it was great fun. Unfortunately, shooting back lots became passe. Everybody has to be done on location for the true nitty gritty of shooting out on the city streets. Westerns became passe, don't shoot them anymore. So the backlot sat there, and in the Eisner years, they tore it all down. The Zorro set is now a giant parking structure called the Zorro parking lot, but it just tore it all out. Now they built others out of the Golden Oak Ranch, which is just, I could be there if I left now in 15 minutes. It's pretty close to here, but so they do all their outdoor filming out there now because the back lot just doesn't have that that capability anymore.
And they never opened those back lots for tours then, did they?
Disney, no. Basically you had Universal came up with the idea of the studio tours, and they're still doing it today. For a while, 20th Century Fox had studio tours, and I've got some really neat pictures taken of the 20th Century back lot, and there's the chariot from Lost in Space is sitting there, and sets from different odds and ends, but then they did away with it. They tore down their whole back lot, and that's now called Century City. a giant industrial housing type area. You can come out though and you can take a tour of Paramount Studios, which is a very small back lot, and you can take a tour of the Warner Brothers Studios, which still has a back lot, not as large as it was when I started working there.
Yeah, we went there. It was a very large back lot at Warner Studios.
Yeah, well, it's a lot smaller than it used to be. There used to be a big Western Street out there that they tore down and built a new building right in my final days there. So probably was twice the size when I was there. And when I was there, it was even smaller. The Warner Brothers lot was so big at one point in time. If you go to where NBC Studio was on Alameda, that was all the Warner Brothers back lot. And it had a lake out there, a huge lake. I've got a picture somebody gave me as a thank you. A number of years ago, we were owned by Time Warner, and we had Life magazine and all that. And I did a project for them of fixing some of their computer stuff. And part of the thing was go and look at all the pictures of the Warner Brothers back lot that they had. And you had where my office was, it was in the former, what they call a termite terrace, where all the animators worked. There were train tracks that came out from around the building and went off and just ended it off in the street. So they used to have full-size trains that they could take and, you know, chug out of sight, you know, going down the road. They sold all that off, and the Warner Brothers back lot was massive at one point in time. Unfortunately, they don't have that anymore. Do you have a list of locations where it was shot, Tom? In addition to Golden Oaks, some of it's Calabasas, Thousand Oaks. I do have some of it in my notes that I did when I did the TV book. And it is interesting to go out and try to match, the shots. And today it's all houses and everything. If anybody remembers the old TV show Combat, Vic Morrow and Rick Jason, and, you know, they slogging their way across France. But the famous thing that they were doing a scene out of Jan's Ranch. It's Janss Ranch, and they did a lot of filming out there, and they were having the problem that other people had was that civilization was cropping up on them, and and like the hill you shoot on one month is now covered, next month with tractors starting to build houses. But one of the performers in the show, made some comment about, someday it's going to be hard to imagine looking back, all this is going to be covered in houses, and everybody's, it will never happen. You know, you go out there today, it's all covered in houses. I mean, there so many, when they did so many of the shows like Westward Ho, the Wagons and everything, shoot it out in Camarillo, shoot it out in Calabasas. You don't need to go to Oklahoma. You need to have a river, we'll just matte paint it in. They did a massive amount of stuff like that. They also did a lot of stuff at the, there's all sorts of movie ranches that were done. We're going to take a drive around sometime, Tom, and go look for some of them. But there was a jungle ranch out in Thousand Oaks where they had all sorts of animals you could rent. And everything.
Jungle Land.
Yeah. And a lot of them came from there. They had and Spin and Marty, when they go off, for the one where they're at the lake, there's the whole thing about wanting the big water meat. That was another ranch at, there were a whole bunch of them around at the time. So
yeah,
it's, when I first moved out here, I got out here and Disney had a car rally club, and you would go off in these car rallies, and they would give you clues about, find this, and go 13.7 miles at 16.7 miles an hour, turn left. And it was to see how precise you could drive. And one of them took us out to Chatsworth. And I had a hard time doing the race because I was so busy looking at all the hills. If people don't know Chatsworth, go look up like Stony Peak Chatsworth and, all these rocks and everything. And, Lone Ranger, where he rears up on the horse and the rock is still there. You can go see it. But so many of that stuff was shot out there. It was the end of the world at the time. If you want a interesting bit of trivia, go watch the first the first serial that they have of Superman, and he's leaving his hometown to go into a metropolis to become a reporter. Well, we all know Superboy grew up in Smallville, but they didn't do that for this TV show. They went to the Chatsworth train station and pulled the first two letters off the name, So he's leaving the town of Atsworth, which they were so chintzy on it. You could see the signs this big, and there's a blank space, and then the words Atsworth. You could just hang a sign, Smallville. No, that takes time. Just pull down CH, put it back when you're done.
It's called being resourceful.
Yeah. You know, it is. You watch so many of these shows, like the old Superman, The Adventures of Superman with George Reeves. So much was shot on the back lot at RKO Studios, the famous 40 acres, it's all gone. And you can still look around and see bits and hills and things in the background. But I was lucky when I got out here, they were just tearing down the last of the MGM lots. I was able to break in, sneak in, find my way onto the back lot there. You know, Disney, of course, had it, Universal. So many of them are gone now. It's, but there are a lot of good books on them, some good books. So any favorite memories or things people didn't remember that brought back to life? Are we all going to go home saying, because if they didn't, they died?
You know, Bill, I was watching all this and you were talking about them sending the movies overseas. And a bunch of years ago, Mark and I went to Germany to take part in a film festival in what used to be East Germany in a town called Jena. And we got on the train in Frankfurt and we're trudging along and we basically crossed into East Germany. And I don't remember exactly where it was, somewhere on the way to Weimar. And there's this American style fort and a teepee and an American flag flying along the side of the railway. And we saw this every time. It's probably still there. And it turns out there was a great deal of interest in the American Old West in Germany. And a lot of it was spurred by a writer named Karl May. But also, so I asked someone who lived there and they said, yeah, we grew up reading these books and watching these movies. And they mentioned the Disney movies coming over, that they'd seen Davy Crockett and they'd seen all these things. And this is what it spurred their interest. But every time we'd go over there, we'd see this in the fort still there. And there's an American flag and a teepee and a look like F troop, but you know, kind of on steroids. but there was a lot of influence there.
Yeah. The start of all that influence was William F. Cody, Buffalo Bill, who took his Wild West over there, and he was extremely popular in Germany and in France, and that's what was the beginning of that.
Yeah, so Carl, the people that write about Carl May mentioned that. The people that write about Carl May mentioned that he's mentioned that as one of his influences. He only ever got to Niagara Falls when he came to the U.S. He never got beyond to the quote Old West.
Yeah,
but he was just totally enchanted with it. Well, but that's really cool. I forgot about Buffalo Bill.
Probably influenced him too.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You know, one thing that's interesting, I forgot to mention, on some of the shows like the Elfego Baca, they would start off by going on location and shooting in New Mexico, and then they would, you know, do the rest of them on the back lot. And then Carol and I were on vacation a number of years ago, and we went to one of the towns, and you bring the picture with you, there's the building, and oh yeah, there it is, and that's, you know, the church down the street, that's where it is and everything. So they would do that. They would go off and in your first episode, they would plant you out in the real part. And we saw when Elfego came riding to town, it was not the Disney back lot. It's just a small town, Bernalillo County or something. But you get out there and your first episode, you see all the hills and the mountains and everything. Then all the others are shot in beautiful downtown Burbank. But they've already implanted in your mind that this is out in the middle of the Great West. So It's they're really smart at what they do with that.
Bill, do you have every episode of the TV show in one form or another? I noticed that some were clearer than others.
I have basically all but 9 episodes of the anthology show. And one of them I just got recently, but it's with a French soundtrack, so it's not doing me a lot of good.
Yeah.
Basically, some of the ones that were not so good, or I mentioned a couple weeks ago chatting, when I worked at the studio, you could take home the movies, you probably did this time, you could take home a projector, a movie, and 3 cartoons. Well, I found a guy that would lend me copies of films in exchange for a bottle of Jack Daniels, and I would copy them in my living room. So some of the ones have not since aired on TV. So, the one you could see a little breakup of we're talking, it's hard to believe, a 40 plus year old Betamax tape. They kind of, some of them, better than others. Some of them they did air again on the Disney Channel. I was a consultant on the Disney Channel for a number of their programming things, particularly Walt Disney. And one of my things I did was, well, what shows don't I have in my collection? And those are the ones that, of course, should be on Walt Disney, right? So, but yeah, I think there's about nine of them. There's like Hurricane Hannah. There's a couple that they didn't rerun because they didn't do as well in the ratings. And then things like Hurricane Hannah, they used all sorts of real footage from the U.S. government of planes flying into hurricanes, and they were all in black and white, so they never reused them in the color years. So if there's any particular show you're ever looking for, let me know. I can, you know. And sometimes I'm being an idiot. I have every version of Davy Crockett, you know, so the very first version where he comes out in, you know, black and white. And then when they what they were doing in a lot of these, they shot the Walt intros in black and white on some of these because they didn't intend to use those overseas. So now when the TV show came out in color, Walt would redo a new introduction to Davy Crockett, and they would, you know, have it done in color. Plus, they also had the same stuff where, you know, over 10 years, like Walt, like all the rest of it, aged a bit. So rather than having, you know, week one of the current Walt, week two of the current, you know, and all of a sudden going back to an eight-year-old Walt, they would redo it so that, you know, Walt would be back looking, you know, like the Walt we saw last week and we'll see again next week. So, that was one of the things when they did the Disney Legends and Heroes thing, you know, I can try to convince them to go back and, they had shot a lot of these things in color. They never used them in color, but I said, hey, for the extra amount of money to digitize it, it costs the same amount of money to digitize a, you know, a black and white movie as it does a color. So why don't we go for the color? So great film archivist at the time, we found as much of the color stuff as we could. And some of that was the first time it had ever been seen in color was on Walt Disney. So. Like I said, I love the shows. You know, the Gallagher shows, you know, I mean, you know, they had great character actors too in them, you know, Edmund O'Brien and Jeanette Nolan and, you know, all sorts of different people in these things. And, you know, they were great to grow up on. Anyone else? Well, I hope people enjoy the trip back to the wild, wild west of Disney. And
when did the Wonderful World of Color come?
That came around 64, I think it was. 61? Yeah, 61. Yeah, basically, Walt had wanted to do color, and he thought it would be a great thing to do, but NBC didn't want his show on his terms, and ABC television wanted it, but ABC was very, very poor. And matter of fact, they had issues on some of their stations, couldn't air the shows on the same time as everybody else because they didn't have microwave transmissions to them. So they would have to air them a day or two later with the off of film, you know, that sort of thing. So when he got into his war with ABC and NBC, by now Walt's in the driver's seat. You know, he went from a pretty much a real minor player. You have to really stop and think back in, you know, the 1953 era where he's starting to think about getting into television. He's done two TV specials for, you know, the Christmas shows, and they were successful. But nobody, you know, Walt was, you know, if you were going to invite the 10 big players to a dinner party, Walt would not have been one of the 10 big Hollywood players. All of a sudden, Davy Crockett comes out and really puts him on the map. And then Zorro comes out and moves him to the top of the map. And then Disneyland the Park comes out. All of a sudden, this guy is on a roll and a half. So he wants to renegotiate his terms of the contract with ABC. NBC comes by and says, whatever they give you, I'll do you better. And he moved over there with a long, long running run for years. And I mean, the anthology series just ran forever. So I had fun one day. I had to go over to NBC and pick up our royalty check and bring it back to the studio. And, you know, it was only a mile and a half down the road. I went over and picked it up, and I got a kick out of, you know, picking up a check. And I think it was some like $3.7 million and no cents. You know, and I got a kick out of no cents. Like, I'm going to think 82 cents on it. But I kept thinking, if I can find a way to cash this check, oh, I could have fun.
But he did all these shows in black and white, but you said he also filmed them in color. So did he re-show them after Wonderful.
Well, yeah, he shot most of them in color. Again, he did a very few of them in black and white because he didn't think that there was any American market for it. So the Moochie shows, like a Moochie of Pop Warner Football, Moochie of the Little League, he did those in black and white because he didn't think, you know, over in England they would care at all seeing a show about foot, you know, Pop Warner Football or baseball. So he did about eight shows in black and white, and like I said, the four of them were the Moochie shows, and some are others that he used footage from the government for things like in Antarctica, stuff like that. In some cases, what they did was they shot all the other stuff other than the Disney footage they shot in color. And then when they later re-aired them, if you were doing a movie about Antarctica, you would just put a blue tint over it to make it look like it's up in the snow. Or if you were doing a thing about a fire, you put a red tint on it. But there were a couple that they just never redid because the vast majority of the footage was black and white because they got it for free from the government. But like I said, they would then take a show like Elfego Baca. It only ran in black and white on network television, but it was filmed in color. They released about four Elfego Baca theatricals because it was shot in color. And then when we got to Walt Disney, I said, well, if we're going to air this, why don't we air the color version? And people have never seen it. And so we were able to take the color movies. They'd all been shot in color, edited in color, but broadcast in black and white. So we just had to basically go back to the color negatives and you know, scan those and use them for Disney Channel.
I'm surprised at how many of the shows you covered. I had no recollection of. They don't even ring a bell with me at all. And I'm probably older than you.
You know, it's interesting because you think about Daniel Boone, you know, oh my God, Fess Parker. And everybody thinks Fess Parker's Daniel Boone was a Disney show, and it definitely was not. But, you know, Disney did his four with Dewey Martin, and, you know, they came, they went, they disappeared. Like I said, for me, I love these shows. So when I started doing the book, it was just great. And Carol's watching, she'll probably remember this. One day I was sitting here and the phone rang and she answered it and she came in and said, it's for you, it's Robert Loggia. And I said, Robert Loggia, the actor? She goes, I don't know. So I picked it up and I said, you know, hello? And if you remember Robert Loggia, it's this gravelly sort of voice. And it goes, are you Bill Cotter? And I said, yeah. And he goes, Bill Cotter wrote this book on Disney television? And I said, yeah. And I'm thinking, oh God, I've made some god awful mistake. I'm going to get my suit off. Or he goes, this is damn great. He was in Miami on a movie filming. They had given him a copy of the book, and he said, I'm not going back to the set till I finish this chapter. I had to call you up and tell you how much I loved it. And, you know, it's, oh, thank God. You know, so that's, again, get to talk to him about some of the stuff. So I love these shows. And I joke earlier, you know, singing my daughter to bed. She's the only one I can think that's ever been sung to bed with the soundtrack of The Boys of the Western Sea or A Rollicking Company. They make things run. They'll soon become the Men of the Western Sea. You know, I mean, Disney stuff that's way gone. Or what you call it, you know, on the southern coast of England is a legend men still tell. You know, and how many kids get sung to death to the Scarecrow of Romney Marsh? But maybe that's how she ended up, how she ended up.
I always understood that Walt Disney's Wonderful World of Color was the first color TV show they showed on the television.
No.
We had a color TV. It was a big deal.
No, color television had been out beforehand, and they were, you know, shows like Bonanza and stuff like that, that they, they wanted them all shot in color to, you know, drive the sale of color TVs. But there was color before. There were actually, color had been going on in the 50s, but there were two competing color technologies at the time. And CBS used a very complicated system with a wheel that spun inside your TV and basically shone a light through it that would split into the colors like in a prism thing to give you color. And then the other studios came up with the system that we use today. So the CBS one didn't last very long at all, but there were experiments and all sorts of people were trying to be the first one in color, the first one, you know. And then Walt, again, he didn't have the first one in color, but he had like the first stereo TV show, you know, you listen to AM on one channel, FM on the other channel, and you could listen to the stereo. So, but it wasn't the first one. Did they ever issue DVDs of The Scarecrow? Yeah, it's actually on Blu-ray. If you ever want to see it, go join the Disney Movie Club, which I can send you a link to it. The Scarecrow, Rodney Marsh, was originally done as a three-part TV series. Then they edited it down to be a two-part, but they also put it out overseas. And the Blu-ray is just outstanding. It's I think it's only available from the Disney Movie Club, but it's a wonderful, wonderful copy. It's a And again, you know, I'd written to Patrick McGoohan, star of another one of my all-time favorite TV shows, because I wanted to get his autograph. And people had told me, whatever you do, don't mention a prisoner, it will set him off. So I wrote him a letter and I said, I don't, because I had all these extra Disney publicity stills. And I sent him a bunch of stills from the Scarecrow of Rodney Marsh and asked, would you autograph one for me and you can keep all these others I'm sending you. And I got back a very nice letter from him, and I had snuck in a prisoner still, hoping he would autograph it. And to my delight and pleasure, he did. But I got back a very nice note from him of, you know, his memories working for Disney. So Scarecrow, and Carol and I went over to England, and our daughter was really young. She was probably about a year old or 2 years old. But we went over to the church. They shot the Scarecrow of Rami Marsh at, and Carol had to stay out in the car with Margo and, you know, give her a nap. And I was able to run around and, you know, be a camera nut. So Scarecrow, great show. Got to go watch it. Well, thanks all. Hope you enjoyed the trip back, and appreciate your joining me. I'm not quite sure what we'll be doing next week, but I maybe we'll go into another realm of Disney television. Maybe we'll do this the Tomorrowland shows or something else. It depends on time available. As you can imagine, it takes a little bit of time to go find all these clips, edit them, and all, put them all together. But so, you know, for me, it's a labor of love. If I have a reason to go watch, like I said, Davy Crockett and the River Pirates, I just can't get enough of it. I thought Mike Fink was just the greatest character, you know, and eating his hat at the end of it. I mean, great fun as a kid, so I enjoyed it. I hope you all did too.
Yeah, I really appreciate all the time you put into this, Bill.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
And, you know, I just loved all that Walt Disney introductions. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Yeah. It's funny that when I was watching Disney and they would show in the beginning, like where, what the story was coming from which land, Disneyland, you know, one Adventureland. And most of the time, if it wasn't Fantasyland, I was like I wanted to see the cartoons and not the Daniel Boone.
Yeah, you actually met Walt Disney in person. So you're like a living legend here.
No, he was a great guy. As I mentioned, I wrote the book on Disney TV, and then they were coming up with a CD-ROM biography of Walt Disney, and they asked if I would do the TV section for it. So I distilled the book down into this TV thing, and then the CD debuted at Disneyland. It was a really fun night. They had the Lincoln Theater, and we all peeked behind the curtain, and Abe was sitting there, you know, dead in his chair. But we're out in the past, people were asking about Walt, and I had never met him, and a lot of the other people had. And his daughter, Diane, was there on the panel. And again, people asked about, you know, the intros and the TV shows, and I mentioned a little bit earlier, I didn't really think a lot of the animal shows. My dad ate them up. I didn't think much of them, but I'd watch them. But I remember mentioning, it was like my Uncle Tom. He had the most bitchin' train set in the basement of the house that you ever saw. It was an incredible model railroad. And we'd go over there for Thanksgiving dinner, and we'd all be down in the basement, and Uncle Tom would be proudly showing us his newest train or the tunnel he built or the little house he had added to it. And the poor women had been cooking all day, would be screaming for the menfolk to get up there and eat, or it's, you know, you're not going to eat. Well, we loved Uncle Tom, and I loved going to Uncle Tom's house to look at his train set, which we did about once a year. And I mentioned in this talk that I felt like Walt was my Uncle Tom, that, you know, there were times Uncle Tom would go into real minutiae about, you know, the whatever, and he didn't want to tell me, that was a little too much for an eight-year-old, but, you know, you would do it. It was the same thing with Walt. I didn't really care for the boy and his aardvark story, but you didn't want to let Uncle Walt down. And that's why Diane came over and said it's one of the nicest things anybody ever said about her father, which really meant a tremendous deal to me. But I just Sunday night watching those shows, and, you know, that they were just growing up on. And back then you got one chance to watch it, right? No DVR, you know, and then, you know, in my house growing up, I didn't get a color TV until I moved to California and bought one of my own. You know, the family never had one back then. So you just, you know, the whole family had to agree on what you were going to watch, because there was only, you know, well, there were only like five channels or something, but if there was something else on, no, we have to watch Walt Disney. And luckily my dad liked it as much as I did. So, you know, it was never a problem. So Sunday night, 7 o'clock, it was the family ritual. Well, great. I hope folks have a good week, and I hope you have good weather wherever you are. We're having some rain out here for a change, which is lovely. And it's dry today. It's supposed to be more rain tomorrow and more rain this week. So keeping the fingers crossed.
Yes. Thank you so much. I loved every minute of this.
Well, thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Bill. And I don't mind promoting it on the Walt page again. This was great.
Oh, thanks, Lee. I appreciate it. You still keeping busy?
Yes and no. I've been derailed by hip surgery. I had hip replacement surgery, but I still keep busy on the page and still keep busy with Disney stuff. So miss Ron and Diane terribly. I used to talk to them regularly.
Yeah, I mean it's still hard to absorb, you know. And yeah. You know, it was when you got the news, you go, holy crap, that just can't be. Yeah. And then Ron was a great guy to work for. You know, we're talking about all the intrigue going on today with, you know, Chapek out and Iger back in and everything. And I was just thinking back in the days I worked there, I could call up and say, you know, I need to speak to the Ron. And, you know, they'd say, well, he's busy. Could he call you this afternoon? Yeah, he can call me anytime he wants. Imagine today, hey, could Iger give me a ring? Yeah, in your next lifetime. It's just a totally different.
Yeah.
Super nice guy. Well, I hope you're mending and back on your feet soon.
Well, thank you much. You take care. And again, thank you for a great program.
Well, thanks. Appreciate it. See you all in a week or so.
Take care. Thanks, Bill. See you next Saturday.
Bye.
Bye-bye.